Since long. Since time immemorial, human beings have invested in gold, have adored gold, and have used gold. The trend still continues and it grows. If we see last year's numbers, last year a total of about 2,900 tons of gold was mined in the world. Fresh gold was mined in the world. And about 4,000 tons of gold was consumed in the world. That's because the other 1,100 tons comes in from recycling. The old gold is recycled and it's used. So, if you see the history, we're at the peak of utilization of gold. Human being today consumes close to 4,000 tons of gold. So it's a big number, it's a big business basically. It's going to continue going forward. Rajesh Exports was formed in the year 1989. It was formed as a partnership firm. In the year 1990, we set up India's first organized jewelry manufacturing facility. Till then, the entire manufacturing of jewelry in the country was in the unorganized sector. There was nothing called as organized manufacturing as such in the country till then. 1990, we started the first facility and we kept growing thereafter. In the year 1995, we came out with a public issue that was our maiden public issue, the only one what we have done till today, for expansion of our manufacturing facilities. And in the year 2000, we set up the world's largest jewelry manufacturing facility. And moving forward, in the year 2010, we set up a gold refinery at Rudrapur, in the state of Uttaranchal. In the year 2011, we imported the first shipment of gold dore bars into India, that is raw gold. We imported the first shipment of dore bars into India. We refined those gold dore bars at our refining facility and produced pure gold bars out of it. By 2012, we started our retailing under the brand name of Shubh Jewelers. By 2014, we have 82 stores under the brand name of Shubh Jewelers retailing our jewelry, jewelry entirely produced by us. In the meanwhile, in the journey, we emerge as the largest exporters of gold jewelry from the country, the largest wholesalers of gold jewelry and gold products from the country. And if you look at our results for the last year, that is, for the year 2014-2015, we posted revenues exceeding 50,000 crores with an EBIT of 1203 crores, pre-tax profit of around 740 crores and post-tax profit of around 650 crores. Since 1995 since we got listed. On revenue side, we have grown around 2,100 times. On the profit front, we have grown 280 times. A CAGR of more than 50% in revenues for the past 20 years and a CAGR of about 34% in profitability for the last 20 years since we were listed. Since inception, growth has been our mantra. As a company, we believe in growing. We believe in delivering quality products. And it is because of these beliefs of ours that today, that is last year, we achieved revenues, record revenues, which no other jewelry company or gold company or diamond company in the country has ever achieved. We topped 50,000 crores last year, as I said, just before some time. So that's the highest revenue, highest EBIT, and the highest profitability by any jewelry company in the country till date. So we achieved that in the year 2014-15. But that doesn't stop our growth story. We have resolved, and as I said, it is our mantra to keep growing. So when we were thinking, when we are deliberating, then how do we grow from here? We already achieved record sales, we achieved record numbers in terms of sales and profits, etc. How do we grow? At that time, we deliberated and we decided that now we will grow by backward integration, we'll integrate backwardly, have a larger footprint in the global market, because even from global standards, we are no more small players. We are an $8 billion company as far as revenues are concerned. So we decided that we need to have a better and a bigger global footprint, including in India. Newmont Mining Corporation is one of the world's largest mining companies. It's the second largest gold mining company in the world. It's a company which was started in the year 1920, listed on the New York Stock Exchange. Since 1925, it's a part of the S&P index. I know I'm going a little away from this presentation, but it's better that I explain myself rather than going slide by slide on the presentation. We can go there later on. So, it's a company listed on, it's a company forming a part of the S&P index, S&P 500 index, and the Dow Jones Global Sustainability Index. This company has several assets. It's a large corporation, old company, it has several assets. One of the prized assets worth in health was one company. Emilio Campanova is the founder of one company. In fact, one company was founded in the year 1961 by Emilio Campanova and a group of other Swiss investors. Newmont Mining Corporation, being a large corporation, they took a policy decision. They decided to focus on their core mining business. That's what they decided. Because of which, they began a thought process of divesting one company. Similarly, the private investors or the founders of one company, they also have grown old. They're all about 75, 80, 85 years old. So they were also thinking of divesting one company because they're all going for retirement. But the question what both these our strength in this business, we were selected as suitors for one company. For the sellers, of course, price is always there. It's a commercial transaction. It's not something which is happening for any other social cause or anything like that. It's a commercial transaction. They definitely required a reasonable price. Price was not their only criteria. Price was not the only criteria. They were worried. In fact, even last when they signed, they told me, look after this in a proper manner. Their criteria was, they wanted Valcambi's name, which is a legend in gold industry. Many of the people who do not know the industry too well, who are just in the industry but don't know too much of depth, they always think Valcambi is something like a central bank, or Valcambi is some big entity which, you know, it's something above the government, or it's a government entity or something like that. So that is the kind of credibility which this company had established, and they wanted this credibility to continue. And we were, I would say, we were selected, we offered ourselves, the deal was done between us, and we were able to get a sign-off on Valcambi. The entire deal, the entire payment has been done. I'll come to the structure of the acquisition in the last interview. Let me explain what Valcambi is for the next 2 or 3 minutes or 5 minutes. Valcambi is the largest gold refinery in the world. Valcambi has a total refining capacity of 2,000 tons, 1,600 tons of gold, and another 400 tons of other precious metals like silver and platinum. It is by far the largest refinery in the world, largest precious metal refinery in the world. It was set up in the year 1961. Since 1961, it has been a consistently growing, profit-making and a dividend-paying company. For the last 3 years, on an average, they refined and sold 945 tons of gold and some 375 tons of silver, which equals to close to 2,35,000 crores of revenue. And the quantity what they have refined and sold during the last 3 years on an average per year is more than what the entire country, what entire India consumes. So theoretically speaking, Valcambi is capable of satisfying the entire need of India as far as gold is concerned. India consumed close to 800 tons last year, and Valcambi sold close to 945 tons last year. Their peak was 1,200 tons, which was 2 years back when the market was different. So that is the kind of capacity what Valcambi has. When we look at the business and the client list of Valcambi, it's something very different. Valcambi supplies to major bullion banks in the world. Some of the major bullion banks in the world. Valcambi supplies to governments. Valcambi supplies to most of the central banks of the world. Bank of England or whatever central banks. It supplies to most of the central banks of the world. The Valcambi brand as such is one of the most credible and the most dependable brand as far as gold business in the world is concerned, global gold business is concerned. Valcambi bars are good delivery bars on every exchange of the world, on every metal exchange of the world. Whether it's Tokom, whether it's Shanghai Metal Exchange, whether it's NYMEX, whether it's COMEX, whether it's London Metal Exchange, whether it's MCXCM. Every metal exchange in the world treats Valcambi bars as good delivery bars. central banks across the world. Malkambi is considered as a gold standard. In fact, I would have liked all these details to be given out by Mr. Michael Masaryk, who was there with us yesterday. In the press meet, we had Mr. Michael, we had Ursula with us. One was the CEO and another one was the global sales head. But they had urgent commitments back home because this deal is leading them there also. Because of them, they had to fly yesterday night. But they were there in the press meet and he would have been able to explain much better than me about what I am talking about World Cup. But anyway, I am basically enacting his role here in terms of explaining what World Cup is. And I am sure I would have left out many things, what he would have explained to you better. So, when we got ourselves to be a suitors of this kind of a global company, we immediately understood that the global doors, as far as the gold business is concerned, have opened for us. We are already reasonably global, but now we have a presence, whereas Valkambi owners, we walk into any bullion bank, we walk into any mining company, we walk into any exchange, we are looked at in a very different way. The best of the mining companies in the world, if anybody wants to get supplies from them, suppose we have a refinery in India here, if you want to ascertain supplies from Barrick's, which is the largest gold mining company in the world, it will be very difficult for me to ascertain any kind of supplies from them because, you know, getting an appointment with them is very difficult. Because they have already set norms. They already are set with many refineries in the world, the best of them, 5-6 refineries which are set there. But with Valkambi now, I will be able to walk into our company or our representatives would be able to walk into any mining company's office and ask for their produce for refining and get a hold, get a control on the gold which is there. Currently, Valkambi has long-standing contracts with major mines of the world with a quantity of around 550 tons per annum. They get 550 tons of gold directly from the mines. Other gold they get as scrap, other gold they get from banks for refining or whatever is there. So this is the kind of strength what this company has got. Now the coming together of Valkambi and Rajesh Exports. In my opinion, in my little experience of 30 years or 35 years, 32 years, whatever I have got in this business, I am sure it would be trend setting and path breaking as far as global gold business is concerned. I got a few calls from some of our association representatives here in India, Bullion Association, etc., this association, some of the best players in our business, they called me today and they said, you have given a new life to this entire industry in India. By doing this, it's going to change the entire paradigm of this gold and jewelry industry in India. Globally, this acquisition will have an effect which will increase the gold business as such globally. Because the reason being very simple. The biggest forward integrated company and the biggest backward integrated company have come together. We have acquired them, but I will definitely say we have come together. We are forming a partnership now. This backward and forward integration, which advantage of which we will get due to the size, even we were having a refinery, even we have interest in some mines. That's all on small levels. And for us, for our refinery or for any refinery in India, to get an LBMA accreditation or to get a good delivery bar status on COMEX or NYMEX, I don't know whether I'll be able to do it in my generation or not. It's very, very difficult. Some of the best refineries, examples are Dubai, there are one or two big refineries owned by the biggest banks of Middle East. They are trying their level best to get LBMA accreditation. They are trying their level best to become good delivery bars on various exchanges. But they have been struggling for the last 5-10 years, they have not been able to do that. So we get straight a hold on good delivery bars. as forward integration is concerned, I think I can proudly say that Rajesh Exports is one of the biggest global players as far as the forward integration is concerned. That is, as far as manufacturing is concerned, wholesaling is concerned, exports is concerned, and retailing is concerned. So when these two come together, it is but natural to form tremendous synergies and to take the best advantage of the situation. Citing a few of them, Warkabi Gold will be better marketed now in Asia. We have a better and a bigger hold than Warkabi in India, in the Middle East and in China. We will be able to penetrate more in these large markets. This constitutes around 60% of the world's global gold markets. We will get a better hold there. Talking about forward integration of Warkabi, the value-added products which Warkabi will make going forward in their facility will be aided by the expertise of Rajesh Exports. That's what Mr. Michael said in the press meet. That some of the products what we are getting made in Italy till now, getting the expertise from Italy, we'll be able to get from Rajesh Exports now. We will get a hold as Rajesh Exports in the markets of Europe and America, which will be much better than what we are doing. They will get Asia, we will get that, Europe and America. So the forward and backward integration strategy is going to be very, very different. And it's going to accrue benefits to both the companies. Plus, we will be setting up a refinery. The refinery which is already there, we'll be upgrading that and giving it under the management of Warkabi for getting it LBM accredited, which will be the first refinery in India to get that. Because with their help, we will be able to get it easily. It's their own refinery, they're going to set up another extended arm here. We are going to do that next. So there are immense possibilities which are possible by this acquisition. And both the companies are even currently, without even talking about synergies, let's forget that there are any synergies for a moment. Even then, both of them are fully functional, growing companies with enviable growth records, good revenues, good profit making, both of them. They can survive on their own also without any, you know, synergies or without coming together or anything. But when it comes together, it forms altogether a different story. The individuality will continue and the synergies will be best taken advantage of. On the balance sheet of Rajesh Exports, this acquisition will have a major impact. This is an EPS accretive acquisition for Rajesh Exports. Most of the acquisitions which have happened till now in Europe or in other developed countries as such, many of them have been of either sick companies or companies which need revival or companies whose revenues are dipping. Maybe a lot of Indians from here will go, 40, 50, 100 people will go, they will set it right, they will put the company in order, etc., etc. These kind of companies have been acquired. Warkabi doesn't fit into any of this category. It is an absolutely healthy company, 100% professionally managed. Newmont Mining Corporation used to visit Warkabi maybe once in 2-3 years. They never used to come. The original owners also never used to come. It's a perfectly professionally run company. It's run like a bank, maybe much more than a bank, because central banks trust them. Central banks put their gold custody with Warkabi. They tell, okay, take this 20 tons, take this 50 tons, retain with you, change it and give it to us. That's the credibility what that company enjoys. So it's a perfectly operating company. There are no issues of any kind. The acquisition has been done with complete consent from the current shareholders without any dissent. It has been done with complete consent of the current top management of the company, including the CEO. It has been informed to all the employees of Warkabi, because most of the acquisitions which have happened in Europe rest when these grown balance sheets are consolidated, there will be a very good, impressive impact on the overall balance sheet of Rajesh Exports as such. Just imagine that it's an Indian company which is going to have control over 40% of the world's gold refined. 40% of global gold, it will literally be fine under our control. So that gives a lot of muscle, that gives a lot of opportunities, it opens up a lot of opportunities for us. Definitely, with this acquisition, we will truly become a global multinational in the true sense of the word. We will take the gold business of Rajesh Exports on a wider global footprint by offering better products, by growing our revenues, by growing the profitability. So net-net, when we see the effect of this acquisition on Rajesh Exports, it is going to be very positive. It is going to be positive on Valcambi also. It is going to be positive on the entire global business as such, global gold business as such. It is not important only from our company's view. This acquisition is as important from our country's view also. Because India is one of the largest consumers of gold in the world, in fact, currently the largest. And this is a facility what an Indian company owns, which can theoretically feed the entire requirement of India. So it's definitely, from our country's perspective also, it is a fairly important acquisition what we have done. Net-net, it will be a positive acquisition on the business, on both the countries. I know you're all analyst community, you'll have a lot of questions, and you would have looked into this, analyzed this, operated this whole transaction, performed an operation on this transaction much better than me. So I would love to hear your viewpoints on this acquisition, and definitely I will try my best to clarify all your questions whichever are there. Even I will learn from your questions, I am sure about that. If there is anything which we can learn and take home, definitely I will take home as well. So I request you to ask any questions, whatever are there in your mind, I will be more than glad to answer the same. Thank you very much.
Sir, first and foremost, RTA's congratulations for acquiring such a wonderful asset. This really gives you a absolutely different platform, podium and profile. First thing which came to my mind, I happened to read this, whatever you have presented, in today's front page of Business Standard, and they have expounded this thing very well. It's, your detailing has made the thing absolutely crystal clear. I think associating with this company or this refining asset will almost change your profile. That was my first point. You would like to comment?
Yes, definitely. When we meet good people, when we associate with people who are as good as us or better than us, one thing I have no reason to disagree that Valcambi's profile or Valcambi's standing in the global market is much ahead of Rajesh Exports. I have no hesitation in admitting this.
Absolutely.
No other gold company in the world has the standing of Valcambi. So where we speak about Rajesh Exports, it is the best what a human being has done in his history as far as gold is concerned. So definitely I agree with you that by associating with somebody who is better and much more credible than us in a proper way would definitely enhance our credibility also in the global market and in Indian markets. I fully agree with your point.
In fact, the newspaper story of Business Standard says that it is catering mostly to the requirements of central banks around the globe. over the last 3 years or 5 years, central banks around the globe have been quietly replacing the US dollar with gold as the material currency of reserve. That is a fact which obviously, I mean, everybody knows. The 3 points come to my mind. One, you have paid $400 million. The company is huge in the sense it's a $38 billion top line company. But the surprising part was its bottom line is big for it. It is not even 1% of $38 billion. The figures mentioned were $33 million. So you have virtually paid, if I'm not wrong, 12 times the net profit. So obviously, apart from the standing, you must be having a computation of payback over a certain period, not necessarily 10 or 12 years, lesser than that. And the one thought which came to my mind was, you said this company has 2,000 tons capacity of refining. And last 3 years, they have done 945 tons of gold and 376 tons of silver. That means if you add up these two, there is a gap to reach 2,000 tons. So essentially, with your association coming to them and your being an $8 billion turnover company, will fill up that gap and you will get ultra pure refined gold from this refining, and your jewelry or your products, which you have mentioned in your presentation, will have a stamp of class when you say welcome the gold used in our products. So my question was, what was your internal plan or working as to the payback period of this acquisition? Number one. Number two, synergy is well understood. Number three, you just mentioned is, they will be setting up a refinery in India, or they will be upgrading your existing refinery to their standards. So if you can expand on these two, 3 points.
Yeah, definitely. Your first question was with regard to the payback period. One very important thing in this acquisition is that Valcambi is a zero debt company.
Yes.
It does not have any debt. In fact, it has a huge cash surplus on its balance sheet, which is sitting there doing nothing. It has been placed with certain Swiss banks who are offering them negative interest. About a 0.25% they have to pay for depositing the money in the bank. That's a big amount. And that big amount, when it is taken off from here, basically, from the acquired amount, means the paid amount, it comes literally to 50%. I don't want to expand more on this because these are all confidential data of a private Swiss company, basically. But it comes literally to 50%.
Excellent. I got your answer.
So, whatever we are investing, we are going to take it back immediately from them in terms of their surplus cash, whatever is that. So the investment, what we are doing, is not going to be very huge. Yes, on one day it is going to be huge for a day. We need to shell out that much money to them. But that money will come back. So you know, it's our company. We can do what we want with that money going forward. So basically, that cash surplus will come back to us. Plus, whatever that rest of the amount which will be really investing, out of that, a reasonable amount of the amount has been funded by Credit Suisse as a long-term debt of about 5 years. So net-net, what we will be ending up investing would be around 65 million, 60 to 65 million net-net, what would go from our pocket as such. But it is also true that the 100 or whatever odd million of debt we have taken from Credit Suisse, that has to be paid off also. Now that debt will be paid off from the profits of Valcambi itself for a period of 5 years. So if you look at the whole asset, net-net we have got it, I think, at a fairly reasonable price.
Perfect.
The land value of this asset, the land where it is, this facility is located and the office is located, itself is close to around $55 million. The machinery value, the plant and machinery value, since 1961, they have been building up on innovation. This is the only refinery in the world which refines gold and produces gold bars with 100% robotic machinery cost of this refinery is considered, it will run into a few $100 million of whatever the plant and machinery what they have got. It cannot be rebuilt this time. It's a very difficult thing to, you know, rebuild as such. So looking at the cost of plant and machinery, looking at the surplus cash, looking at the land and building value, I think what I can think from my wisdom and our team's wisdom, I think we have got a good deal overall. And I don't know whether you still agree with me or you still do not agree with me.
No, I agree. I got the, because this could not be put in the news. And
it's because we are there in, bound by confidential agreement. Even then, some one or two medias have carried this, found out from somewhere and they have carried it. That's a different thing. So this is as far as the, you know, payback is concerned. And I'm very sure that looking at the synergies, looking at all the things what we are going to get out of this, looking at bringing the raw gold into India directly from the contracts what they have got with mining companies, etc. In 3 years, we will have a payback period of this entire investment. Less than 3 years.
Fantastic.
We are sure about this. We are working towards that and we should be able to achieve that. Coming to the next question, which was primarily with regard to, I think it's related to synergy, where you said that when you are putting up this refinery here, how about the extra capacity, what you are going to use, etc. See, the capacity as far as a gold refinery is concerned works in a very different way. It's a reasonably cyclic kind of business. Suddenly, a central bank from somewhere gives 50 tons to Alkami, 50 tons of gold, I mean. These are numbers are unheard here, but that's a fact there. Suddenly gives 50 tons of gold and asks them to convert it into smaller parts. That they want in 7 days' time. Or 10 days' time, for whatever reason. It regularly gets this kind of orders and this kind of things. So to deliver that, they need to have this 2,000 tons of capacity.
Okay.
If they are working on a tight schedule of 2,000 to 2,000 or 1,600 to 1,600, they will not be able to, because some days they refine 2,600 tons on an average, means 5 tons a day. But it is not so. Sometimes they refine 5, 6 tons, sometimes they refine 2 tons. Sometimes they refine 1 ton, because this is gold. This is not a cement factory that, you know, you keep getting the raw material, etc. Gold raw material is very scarce. It is not something which can be produced overnight. So you need to have a peak refining capacity to meet those days when they need you to do that. That is where they charge them a little extra. That is where they make their money. Because nobody in the world would accept that 50 tons of gold from a central bank. Central bank, first of all, won't give to anybody.
Yeah.
Basically, because the credibility factor comes into picture.
Yeah.
Maybe another one or two refineries which are there as credible, like Perth, etc., they may get it. But they will not be able to accept that loan. They will say, we don't have the capacity to refine this. What will I do by taking this? In 7 days, I can't turn around this. So it is in these kind of times that they need the capacity. And definitely, the 945 tons what they have refined leaves another 650 tons capacity spare. We as Indians would try to impress upon them and try to influence upon them to make good with that capacity and make the best out of it. That all those tries will definitely be there. Now the reason of putting up a refinery in India is not exactly to add to the capacity, but the reason is to make the best out of it here. A refinery in Switzerland, a refinery in Australia, a refinery in India has different meanings. It is the raw material what you get, how you get, how it is treated by the government, what concessions it gives you, etc. These all play into a big play. It comes into a big play. That is why you need to have credible refineries in wanted spots. Today, African governments, many African governments are after us asking us to put up a refinery in Africa. Because entire Africa is such a big continent, it has only one refinery called Rand Refinery, which is controlled by South Africa. Now, Ghana, the entire Western Africa and entire Eastern Africa, they want a refinery of their own. But they are not able to set up. Setting up a gold refinery is not easy. Especially getting the accreditation is impossible because they have got some kind of, you know, stranglehold on that. They don't allow others to do. As I said, this Dubai refinery owned by one of the biggest people we can imagine. Now, they are trying for the last 7-8 years. They have not been able to get the gold. They are not allowing them to come in the club. The whole problem. Now, if you don't have an accreditation on your gold bar, what will you do with your gold bar? You can at the most come to a retail shop and convince the retailer, "Hey, ye bhi achha hai, ab le lo." They can central bank will buy from me? Which government will buy from me? They'll say, no, 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 we need an accredited bank. Only then we can trust that this is the correct purity. But then what do I know if it's gold, silver, copper, nickel, what is there in there? How do I know? It's very difficult. They can't test each bar. You can't take about, if there are 5,000 bars, cut each bar and test. It's not possible. So that is why you need this accreditation. So getting the accreditation is very, very difficult. Now, in Africa, if you put up a refinery, the government is giving huge concessions. That is, come on, put up an accredited refinery, we'll give all our raw material to you because you're doing forward integration for us. We give you 1% concession. So putting up refineries in the geographical locations, certain locations, becomes very important. A similar concession is offered by Indian government also, which I can't exclusively discuss that here. So it makes a big difference, basically. So that is the reason why you need to have a refinery in India also, because an accredited refinery in India will have a huge advantage. I will be able to pull all the old gold in India, that is the used gold, which is a very big business in India. I will be able to pull this gold, I will be able to send it to this refinery, manufacture accredited gold bars and sell them back in the market, give it to the exchanges or export them, which is not possible today because there is no accredited refinery here. So that is the primary reason we would like to put that accredited arm of that refinery here. You know, if one company starts its operations in India, it makes a big difference for Indian gold industry as such. It's a very different game altogether after that. There's, I think, two or any other question you had?
Yeah, one last question.
Yeah. Forward integration. Some better value-added products where they get a little extra premium. That little means big. Even if it is little, the revenues are so big, it means a big thing, fundamentally. In fact, while I'm answering this question of yours, I would definitely like to share our larger vision, which will give you the exact, which will give everybody the exact reason behind this acquisition. The large or the long-term reason is very different. The short-term benefits of this acquisition are definitely there, but they are not as exciting or as interesting as the long-term benefit. On a long-term, we have a definite plan, the vision or the dream, whatever you call, to ensure that this 1,200 tons of gold, which is controlled by Valcambi or which is refined by Valcambi, is that's one of the major reasons we put forward in this acquisition rationale, which made them to come to us, basically. So, this entire 1,200 tons, imagine just for a minute, hypothetically, if I'm able to sell it in retail, in the US, in Canada, in India, in Australia, in Southeast Asia, wherever, if I'm able to globally sell this, then we are looking at a profitability of 7%, 8% on retail, minimum net profitability. And when we do that, we are talking of a top line of $60 billion and a bottom line of around $5 to $6 billion from the same operation. We have to meet the value chain. We have to cut each one and move forward and increase the volumes going forward. That's the bigger dream. Another 10, 12 years, I'm quite confident we will be able to achieve. In fact, Rajesh Exports, whenever it has told its dreams, people have had some apprehensions. But today, in fact, 5 years back, I had told that in 5 years we'll be reaching a sales of 30,000 crores. But we have reached 50,000 crores. At that time, 30,000 crores was an unimaginable figure in the industry. But we have reached 50,000. So similarly, maybe 2 years back, if I have told that I'm going to acquire Welcome, people would have kicked me out of the room. They would have said, what nonsense you're talking about. It's not possible, basically. But we have done that. So similarly, this 1,200 tons of gold, we have a vision to sell it in retail. For that, we'll be doing a lot of things. We'll have brick and mortar stores across the world. We will have e-commerce platform, one of the best and largest e-commerce platform we'll have. We are developing that platform, where we will ensure that we supply our gold to an individual who wants gold right from Alaska to Australia. He has to simply click a button, he gets the 10 gram bar. He gets the 50 gram bar, whatever he wants. So that's our mission. Even if I increase the profit of Valkabi from 0.1% to 0.3%, it's more than sufficient. Then there is big gap still up. For reaching 10% is a big gap, which is what we want to cover in the next 10 to 20. It is at that time that we'll emerge as a truly global corporation, which will be respected by everybody, telling them, oh, this is the company which is the best in the world. It processes 1,200 tons of gold, refines, sells on its own. So that's the dream. That's the larger picture which we have. But it's a 10, 12 years of time is there, but that is where we are walking towards. This acquisition is primarily for that. That's the thing. I hope I have answered your question.
Marvelous. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you and all the best.
Rajesh, by taking your last answer forward, Shubh Jewelers would be an extension of what you have done in manufacturing in local. So could you give us a sense of your 80 odd stores that you have, what kind of turnover they do and what kind of margins you get in the retail business?
I'll answer your second question first. Margins, what we get in retail business at Shubh Jewelers are between 7 to 8%. Talking of net margins. The business what we do compared to our overall business is just around 2-2.5%. Because we have still not focused fully on retail. We started retail, we learned the game, we understood what this game is, then we got busy in this acquisition, basically. So retailing as such, currently no, it is a 1,000 crore business even today. It's not a small business, logically. But looking at our turnover, our size, it's small business, basically. So we do about 1,000 crores there, we do another 4,000-5,000 crores in India, in wholesaling. So we do get around 10% of our revenues from domestic operations. So it's not a small revenue, we get that. But that will be scaled up very fast now, once we go forward, because we have to scale up our retailing. We will be doing that. And there, definitely, comfortably, we are looking at margins of 8 to 10% very comfortably going forward. Because as far as we are concerned, and when you compare us with any other jeweler in the world, I would say, nobody has this integration. Nobody. Every jeweler in the world, I don't want to take names because it's not prudent on my part to take names. Every jeweler in the world buys jewelry which is manufactured by somebody else. There is no jeweler in the country or in the world who has his own manufacturing facility. They take, procure ready-made jewelry and they sell it at their stores, basically. That makes a difference of around 4 to 5% in margin. It's a big difference. Now, at Shubh Jewelers, that is what response to suit jewelers, basically. So that we are going to now improve and increase. We are capable of giving jewelry at around 5% lower cost than any other jeweler and end up making more money than that jeweler because of our integrated operations. So that is our strength. And that is the strength which we want to show it to the world moving forward.
So one more question on the corporate governance issue. Your share price has run up 2.5 times in the last less than a quarter. So is it that news of this acquisition was out, or is it something else?
As far as the share market is concerned, you people are better judges. You know it much better than us. We definitely don't follow share market. We don't understand share market.
Sir,
if you ask me gold prices, I will definitely answer you.
Sir, the reason why I'm asking is that you have not been a person who has been attending or having analyst meets regularly. So the timing of the meet, this acquisition, the share price movement, it all gives you a little bit of suspicion. So I'm asking you a hard question, straightforward, rather than sugarcoating it and asking.
Absolutely no problem.
So something that is there, I mean, it seems to be a little like playing to the gallery. Oh, hero picture release hone wala hai, uske pehle kuch love affair ho jata hai, hero heroin ka, something like that.
इसमें क्या होता है कि प्रोड्यूसर चाह के लव अफेयर कराता है कि हकीकत में हो गया, वो तो किसी को मालूम नहीं है। कभी कभी हकीकत में हो जाता है, कभी कभी चाह के कराता है, और कभी कभी लव अफेयर होते शादी भी हो जाता है। अगर हमारा प्राइस आज भी देखो तो हम ईपीएस में आज भी टाइटन से 1/3 है। तो ईपीएस से क्या बोलते हो आप उसको, मल्टीपल में, लेकिन स्टिल वी आर 1/3 ऑफ टाइटन। गिव दी बेस्ट एग्जाम्पल। अभी तो इसमें बहुत शादी और लव अफेयर बाकी है, बेसिकली आप देखेंगे। So our market cap even today is much lower than Titan, what I see. But as far as I can't, that's a wonderful company, that's a fantastic company, even Titan. But aap agar strength dekhenge, to strength to aap compare karo dono ka, ki iska kya strength hai aur uska kya strength hai. Ye log 30 saal se manufacturing mein hai, 30 saal se sone ko andar se baat jante hai ye log ki kya hai, aur itna wholesale karte, itna export karte, itna retail karte hai. To I think किसी को अगर आइडिया आया होगा कि ये लो ऑफर होने जैसा है तो उसने किया होगा। सिंपल है, यू नो, वी बेसिकली वी डू नॉट टेक इंटरेस्ट इन दिस थिंग्स, लेट मी ऑनेस्टली टेल यू, बट आई एम कॉन्फिडेंट दैट मार्केट विल वैल्यू अस प्रॉपर्ली गोइंग फॉरवर्ड, दे विल हैव टू वैल्यू अस, क्योंकि रास्ता ही नहीं है। मार्केट में आप आगे बढ़ते जाओ, परफॉर्म करते जाओ, तो मार्केट आपके पीछे आएगी। अच्छे प्रमोटर किधर है, बहुत कम है। आप अच्छी तरह काम करते जाओ, अपने आप पीछे आएंगी मार्केट। सिंपल है, दैट्स माई पॉलिसी।
Sir, let me take you up on your last offer where you said, ask me about gold. What's your forecast on gold prices in the next 12 months, 18 months?
See, gold today is an international currency, basically. And iska forecast karna is very, very difficult for anybody. Let me honestly tell you. If anybody forecasts gold, it's very, very difficult. It's not dependable, it's not believable. Who is the forecast is? Even if Fed chairman or chairperson comes and talks about gold price, I don't think it will happen that way. Because there are hundreds of factors which are there. Kahin pe war ho gaya, kahin pe collapse ho gaya, ye ho gaya. Everything has an effect and impact on gold price. But looking from experience point of view, what is there as such, lag raha hai ki it's at a reasonably low level now. Or it can turn back from here. This is a personal experience, but ye bolne wala bewakoof hai. Nobody can predict gold price. It's very, very difficult. But I feel basically that it should have a turnaround from here, kind of thing. Some turnaround at least, a little bit at least. Thanks.
What's the funding plan for $400 million?
The funding plan, we have partially funded this by a debt, a long-term debt from Credit Suisse, Zurich, and a major part of this has been put in from internal accruals. It's already been funded. There's nothing like funding, but the balance sheet had the strength and the balance sheet had the capacity to fund this acquisition on its own also. Because we have been, sitting on this war chest. If you look at our cash balance, you can understand when you see our balance sheet. So we have adequate cash to fund this, and that is what we have funded it from. I should have covered structure. Basically, Rajesh Exports Limited, India, has a 100% subsidiary in Singapore. is called as REL Singapore Pte. Limited. This subsidiary has formed a 100% subsidiary in Switzerland, which is called as Global Gold Refineries. That's a subsidiary which has been formed. Global Gold Refineries has acquired 100% shares of European gold refineries, which were held earlier by Newmont and the private Swiss investors, basically. And European gold refineries, 100% owns Vulcan. That's the structure. It's a four-step-down subsidiary which is there. Rajesh Exports, REL Singapore Pte. Limited, Global Gold Refineries, European Gold Refineries, and Vulcan. This is the structure in which it is there. One more interesting thing I would like to share when we are talking about the structure, etc., is the pedigree of one company. If one looks at the pedigree or the birth of one company till today, it is very interesting. One company was started in the year 1961 by Emilio Campanovo and his group, whatever the people they had. They started this refinery, they started this operation. And in the year 1983, this entire operation was taken over by Credit Suisse. Credit Suisse, we all know what strength it has, well, what bank it is, what capability it has got. So Credit Suisse took over this entire facility in 1983. They became sole owners of Vulcan. Till 2003, Credit Suisse was the owner of Vulcan. Till 2003. In 2003, the bank decided to focus on its core banking operation and decided to divest Vulcan. Now when they decided to divest Vulcan, you look at the interesting point that the previous owners or the founders, they themselves came forward and they said that, yes, give this facility back to us. Basically, so they took a part of it and Newmont came forward and Newmont took a part of it. So that shows the credibility of this facility, that the previous owners who had already sold, they stepped in back again to take it from Credit Suisse. Now, this, when it is further being divested by Newmont and the private shareholders, the interesting thing is Credit Suisse has again stepped in back in funding this. So it shows the confidence of Credit Suisse in this asset. Confidence of the previous owners, confidence of the Credit Suisse. So that speaks volumes about the quality of this asset. Because Credit Suisse knows about this asset inside out. वो तो उन्होंने रह चुके हैं 20 साल। अगर उनको कोई भी डाउट होता, तो देखो सकते हैं इसमें आपको आते नहीं हैं। We'll not fund this kind of thing. If the owners had any doubt, they would have not taken it back from Credit Suisse. So this speaks volumes about the credibility of this asset. Any further questions?
Sir, you have very nicely explained the backward integration, valuation of LNG financing plans, and the turnover and margins. Now, couple of questions. One is, you talked about this 33 million and the total turnover. Can you share with us the cash flows of this company? What are the cash flows coming? Are they based on 33 million or are they based on the total gross revenue?
No.
In one company.
33 million you are telling, right?
That's the net profit.
Yeah, yeah. The
so what about the cash flows? Are they based
on? The cash flows are clearly based on the EBITDA or the profit itself.
Right.
Because
yeah.
It is a debt-free company.
Yes.
It does not have any other interest burden or anything like that. So the entire cash flow comes in from the profit itself. Whatever they get as profit, usually their policy has been they get the profit into the company and they give away 30-40% as dividend to the shareholders. So about 10 million or something they give as dividends, 10 million to each one of them, 8 million to each one of them. The rest of it they keep it in the company as cash chest or that has been piling up. That's all. The cash flows are completely controlled by the profit of the company.
Yeah.
There is no other, they do invest in the, you know, technology or upgradation of the technology, that is the only cash flow which goes out. They have a policy to, you know, invest this much every year or some part of it, they have a policy. Then they keep investing. Otherwise, most of the profit comes in as cash flow.
Right. So, that way, while company is a low-risk business, there is no risk related to total gross revenues and expenses, right?
It is an absolutely zero-risk business.
Yeah, zero-risk.
There is absolutely no risk at all because it is a job worker. अगर आप मुझे सोना देंगे तो मैं करूंगा, नहीं देंगे तो मैं चुप बैठूंगा। हां, उसका जो खर्चा होता है, व्हाटएवर द एक्सपेंडिचर इज, दैट दे विल हैव टू बेयर, बट इट्स नॉट मच। 220 puts its hands back, then we'll be left nowhere. Because that 300 tons of gold which they're getting from Newmont is very important for the, you know, blossoming or basically moving forward of Malkabi. So that itself takes care of the khacha, whatever is their expenditure. So it's an absolutely safe business. It can be told as a zero risk business.
Second thing is, since you highlighted the strengths of Rajesh Exports, vis-a-vis Titan, particularly your legacy and strengths, and since you're having Analyst speak now, can you share indication or some guidance would you like to give for India operation and global operation so we can track it on a quarterly and regular basis as we're tracking other companies?
Yeah. In fact,
for India and global separately in terms of revenue.
Yeah. We don't have the practice of giving guidance as such, but I can just give you some kind of an indication of what we have got. Global operations and India operations. In India operations, I think with all these things what has happened, the acquisition, etc., what has happened, we look at a growth, comfortable growth of around 20 to 25% in terms of profitability and in terms of revenues. Now, when you look at the global operations, that is when you look at the consolidated operation, even Rajesh Exports has its global operations on a standalone basis also. So what I told you now is for the entire Rajesh Exports. Now when you look at consolidated basis, I think we are looking at a rate of around 35 to 40% growth in profitability, and I think we are looking at around again the same 30-35% growth in terms of revenues.
Globally, consolidated.
Globally.
So overseas growth will be higher than India growth because of your acquisition.
See, the first consolidated numbers which come from Malkabi, they themselves will boost it up. After that, we are talking of this growth. After that, the first numbers are, it's there, that they are basically inconsequential because they are in any case going to come. So I can't call that as my growth because I'm starting from zero kind of thing. So we already have some global operations even now. To that it will add. And then further from there it will grow at this kind of rate. Basically that's what we feel. In fact, the testimony is our CAGR, what you see for the last 20 years. We have grown at over 50% for the last 20 years. And we have grown in revenues, I mean, and in profits, we have grown at about 32-33% for the last 20 years. I think we will try and continue that growth rate.
When can we expect the benefits of Make in India plans for?
So
when can we expect the benefits of Make in India to come?
I think we are looking at a year from now, 1 year. Because to get the accreditation transferred and all that, it takes some time. It's a process which is there. We already started working on that. In about, I think, a year, we will see those benefits. And they will be quite substantial as such.
Lastly, can we expect regular conference calls or analyst meets at least on an annual basis and conference calls for him?
No, definitely, I think we would love to do that. And we have one around here, whom we have, this has been our first request or our thing to them, telling them we would like to have, see, we are in Bangalore. So there we have a little distance problem, but there are Bangalore companies which regularly do this. Just because they're in Bangalore doesn't mean we can't do this. We would like to do it, no doubt about it, and we have requested them to gold, whether it is in retailing or wholesaling or in refining, is going to remain gold. Nothing is going to happen to that. Yes, the risks like theft, stealing, etc., they're all insured. There are enough and more international insurance companies available to insure those risks. So logically, retail gold business, apart from the day-to-day expenditure, basically which would be there to run the show, all the advertisement costs, etc., which would be associated, there's no other much risk as such. It is not like textile business or electronics business, where you put up an inventory of 100 crores, you make about 100 different outlets in India or anywhere else, and suddenly the thing goes out of fashion, or you don't sell it, and what do you do with those garments? This becomes zero. That is not the case with gold. Gold is always gold, whether I convert it into a jewelry or whether I convert it into whatever. Now for me, it has a specific and a special advantage because my conversion costs are the lowest in the world. So I take the gold, convert it into my unit, Garka factory, there is nothing which I am going to lose, whatever the 0.5% I incur in conversion. That is what is my risk if I am not able to sell this gold. Whereas for any other jeweler, he buys it from somebody like me or a lower level than me. He pays around 4-5%. So if he wants to melt it and bring the gold back, he loses 5%. But I lose only 0.5%. So that way also it's a kind of risk-free or a better advantage business for me. Can you put in the last slide that shows the slide before this? Yeah. So we have the list here. See, we have listed out, I think, nine largest gold refineries in the world. Out of that, I think two or three are in Switzerland. Then we have the best and the most credible competitor is the Perth-Mead. That's a very credible, it's a credible name as Welcome, or maybe a ship better than Welcome. It's a AAA rated company, rated more than the rating of the US government. Basically, Perth-Mead. So that is a very credible company. Others also, there are quite reasonably good companies, but if you look at the capacity of our company, basically, it far outpaces or outreaches anybody else. It is one of the oldest outfits also. It's been established in 1961. So others are also, they're as old as that, but some others are new also. So these are the competitors, but what happens here is in refining business, competition means your association with the mines. What kind of contracts you have with the mines. Alkali has long-standing contracts with the mines. So it is a shade better than other refineries when it comes to that. Even Perth-Mead has very good contracts. Basically, all the Australian gold goes to Perth-Mead. So other refineries may not come in the same genre as Valkambi and Perth-Mead. I think others are privately owned kind of things that can be easily. Perth-Mead is government of Australia. Retail, we may look at organic growth fundamentally, but if we get an opportunity to acquire something in retail, we may not hesitate from doing that. If you get the right value, if you get the right pricing and the right kind of credibility, we may not hesitate from shy away from that. But our plan as far as we are concerned is that we are going for organic growth itself in retail. In fact, as far as acquisition is concerned, we will, this inorganic growth is concerned, we may look more on the backward integration side, like acquiring mines or like acquiring further refineries, etc. That will be on the backward integration. Forward integration, I think we would like to have our brand name. Maybe we would like to have Shubh as a global brand name in jewelry, or Kambi as a global brand name as far as bars are concerned. That's the kind of combination what we're trying to do.
This way.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions for you. In this acquisition, do the current management or employees of Kambi have any stake? Have you bought that out also?
I will answer question by question. Okay. The management or employees of Welcome did not have any stake. The entire stake was held by Newmont and the other private investors who were there. And we have bought out 100% of the stake. Okay. Now, while you are asking this question, one more thing comes in my mind which I should clarify. This acquisition, as I said, has been done with the consent of the employees.
host club, you know, getting accreditation. So a lot of what Welcome enjoys in terms of its goodwill is a function of the current employees. And they're probably going to, and since you're dealing with the central banks, you also have custody. And you know, there's a lot of credibility involved with custody that comes in place. So what would be your kind of retention strategy for the current employees? You know, because they leaving could also impact the relationship with some of the top central banks.
This is a very, very important question as such. In fact, with the top management, top five people, the CEO, CFO, global sales head, and technical head, and one more security head, we have already signed with them. For retaining them, from both sides there is a fear. From their side also there is a very Indian coming in, tomorrow he may kick me out, tomorrow he may remove me. That is a fear. I also have a fear that among these five, if anybody leaves, I will be in trouble. Because they have a face there, it's because of their face. You know, you talk of Michael Mezrich. He's a force in the global business, global gold business. If his name comes, it means credibility. If Michael Mezrich says something in gold business, it's understood that he has a pakai kind of thing. So we have already signed, it's a mutual signing. It's not a signature or it's not an agreement by force. Both of us have mutually agreed, the five of them and our company, that they will be retained for the next 5 years. We are going to retain them for the next 5 years and they will be an asset to the company. So what I believe is even if I want to reduce expenditure in Welcome, or if I want to grow Welcome, that need not be done by sacking any of these five people because these are billers. So there's no question of shaking them or anywhere like that. You would rather grow the profitability of Welcome by getting more value addition, by getting better business and by increasing our profits. And if required, maybe some expenditures in terms of other kind of expenditures, not necessarily salaries, which we would like to prune down and bring the profitability a little higher.
So my question was more from a retention strategy. You know, how do you keep these people? Do you incentivize them? Do you?
This is very good with Welcome. All this team of five people who are the core of Welcome, actually, these five are the core of Welcome. They have been there with Welcome for the last about 12, 13 years now. And they have an internal bonus policy. That is, whatever it earns more, they distribute a percentage to these five. And also a percentage of that percentage to the other employees. So all that has been taken care, it has been agreed that these bonuses will be kept because it is not anything new they have demanded. They have only said that you continue with what is going on, we will always be with you. So that has been continued, that has already been signed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sir,
this is regarding the domestic refinery industry as such. As I understand that the government does not allow domestic refiners to provide coal to the various banks which will ultimately supply to wholesalers as well as retailers. And you mentioned that either you will form a JV with some other refinery or you will open your own refinery. So are you saying that this new refinery or the JV will supply to only Rajesh Export, or do you see after, let's say, 5 years government might allow domestic refineries to supply to banks? So what is
there is nothing like not allowing the domestic refineries to not to supply to the bank. There is no rule as such like that. The issue here is, as I said, the accreditation. Banks will not buy gold from anybody which does not have an LBMA accreditation. Because banks have their name at stake. If State Bank of India gives you 1 kilo gold bar, or if Credit Suisse gives you 1 kilo gold bar, you are trusting Credit Suisse and taking that bar. Or you are trusting State Bank of India and taking that bar. Now, if that is not refined properly by any local refinery, then the problem is that State Bank of India's trust is at stake, or their credibility is at stake. So they don't buy gold usually from non-accredited sources. They take gold only from accredited LBMA refineries, the refineries which are certified by LBMA. It's a very, very difficult to do, a difficult thing to get. So that is why Welcome be coming into India and then they doing refining and then they getting their certification and accreditation here in India as well will open up a completely new area of business in India. should I not reap that benefit? Why should I join mine with them and make him smaller? That's not good. So I will rather go with him and become bigger. That's better.
Thank you, sir.
I have a follow-up question. When you talk about the refining business, can you just throw some light in terms of how does this work? Like, for example, we talked about Reliance. So there is, it works on the concept of a cross-refining margin, which is multiplied by the throughput. Is that some sort of a refining margin established per ounce or per ton of gold, and how much that does it fluctuate, as it happens?
There is a fixed refining cost and wastage which is allowed. That is, when they give, let's say, 1 ton of gold or whatever ounces of gold, it is decided that this much of percentage, say 0.05% or 0.08% or 0.1% or whatever, that will be the wastage which will be allowed. And a particular amount per ounce will be paid as refining cost. This is incorporated in the agreement which is signed between the mine and the refinery. Already incorporated, that doesn't change, that doesn't fluctuate with gold prices or anything like that. That's a fixed thing. So they keep paying that, and the gold wastage which is allowed by them, refinery saves in that ultimately, because Walkambi is the lowest gold wastage refinery in the world. Because of the technology, their wastage of gold is very, very minimal. It's basically numbers which cannot be believed in India. It's at that kind of low wastage they function the refinery. So that's a fixed income. There is no change, no variation as such.
So what is that refining margin, if you can share that?
But that refining margin is around, logically around 0.2 or 0.3%, between 0.2 and 0.3% of the gold cost totally, which is there. 0.3% you can say. Usually, if you look at the balance sheet, 0.3% is the income and around 0.2% is their expenditure. So they end up by getting 0.1% as such. So now there is a play possible there that how do you make that 0.2 and 0.3 to come down to 0.2? Then your margins will become double.
But is that, that can only happen if you do refining, right? Because if you're saying it's such an efficient facility with just 200 people, fully automated, in a place like Switzerland where power cost is also optimal.
Yeah, absolutely. So there are other ways. In fact, wastage, they are the best. Nobody can do anything with that. They are superb in that. But there are other expenditures which can be brought down that we are discussing. There are certain administrative expenses and there are certain management expenses, not necessarily salaries as such. Maybe salaries at a different level we can speak of. The top management we are not going to touch. We are not going to change anything there. So basically, there can be some cut applied in these places, and then we are looking at value-added products going forward. So instead of selling it at that 0.1% profitability or 0.3% over the mine cost, we would like to sell it at 0.5%, 0.6%, 0.8%. So both combined together will have an effect on the profitability of one company.
Thank you.
India operations, of course, we have two expansion plans. One is the retailing, what we are going to expand. So there, based on our associate model, what we have, we don't have too much of a capex going into that, because the shop, the everything else is contributed by the associate who joins us. We need to only invest in the inventory. So if you look at the inventory cost, it will be quite substantial inventory cost, but that cannot be exactly classified as a capex. Basically, it's a working capital what comes in. Other capex would be the upgrading the refinery of India when Walkambi steps in. So that would be the other cost, but that will also be reasonably minimal. So
not much,
maybe we are looking at 40-50 crores of capex in terms of actual upgradation of manufacturing facility. We don't have any long-term loan, as I said. We don't have any debt as such. But the working capital interest, it ranges, basically if you take a packing credit, then it is around 6%, 6.5%, 7%. If you take a dollar denominated, then we get 4%. There are various different levels of interest rates there.
So, when you say you are doing job work in Walkambi, this 38 million is what is the notional value of sales?
It is the invoices what they raise. Selling after doing the job work, the gold is sold by them.
Okay.
The gold is sold by them. There is a fixed price of gold called as LBMA AM or PM fixing. oil company's job to sell it further. They would have sold it to their customers before. It's a backward forward they go and they settle the price. So it's actually the invoice value. They raise an invoice, they get that much money, they transfer it to the mines.
Okay. And how is the working capital cycle, how is the cash flow of the Valkambi as well as the
market? Valkambi, there is nothing much called like working capital or anything like that. Because whatever they get in advance for refining. They don't pay for the raw material or anything like that. They get it for refining, they refine it, they sell it and then they pay. So it's a negative cash flow, you can say, or whatever. They don't need to invest in the raw material. Because based on their trust, people give raw material to them. Whether it's scrap or whether it's Doria or whatever, they get it. So there's nothing much like a working capital. That's why they don't have a debt. They only need huge working capital in terms of having the gold inventory to add to the refining process. If they want to refine 10 tons of gold, they need another 10 tons of gold to be added to it. Mix it up and then refine it. So that they have huge limits from various banks in Europe as gold loan. It is not in terms of money. It's at ridiculous prices of 0.3% per annum, etc. What they have.
And can you tell about your cash flow? Because your operation cash flow is negative.
Exactly. We have
celebrate what we buy.
Yeah. We regularly do have negative cash flow cycles. We import or we buy on credit. And we sell on cash. So we have a negative cash flow. That is what you see as huge cash surplus on our balance sheet. What cash you see, it comes up from
cash from operation or negative?
No, that is you're talking about margin from operation. That is not negative. That is you're talking about cash flow. It is negative because of certain last minute overdrafts, etc. taken. It is not actually negative. There's nothing called as cash flow negative in us because what we do is we import on credit. And we sell on cash. So basically, when we do that, we have surplus cash in us. Now that surplus cash, if you have paid off to the creditors during the end of the year or whatever, we have reduced that credit from the creditors, then cash flow will actually come into negative. That is, last year, let's assume that I had 8,000 crores of creditors outstanding. And this year, I have only 6,000 crores. So 2,000 crores goes out of the cash flow. Business. So that is why you are seeing it as negative. It is not a hard figure wherein any cash has gone out of the company. It was to be paid by the company and it has been paid. That is why you are seeing it as a negative cash flow. So we have this negative cash cycle as I was explaining you. We import first, on credit, export, get the money, put it in the bank and then pay the creditor. Now that is because of our standing in the international market that we get that credibility or credit from the supplier. China is definitely limited and the presence of Valkambi also is not so great in China. They do have presence, they are supplying to Bank of China, etc. But together we have decided that with us and them doing a joint marketing exercise there, we would be increasing our presence and their presence both in China. That's what we have decided.
Sir, can you elaborate more about setting up the Valkambi operations in India? Like, how do you think would go about it? Would there be incremental capex for that? So land would be acquired or what?
No, we already have a refinery. As I had answered this capex question, we already have a refinery. We need to only upgrade that refinery with the technology and certification from Valkambi. So they know the exact technology, they know the exact certification process. So they will come and do that. They will acquire that, we will hand over that refinery to them.
So I think the present refinery would be in the books of Rajesh.
It's in the books of Rajesh Exports.
But that would be then transferred to Valkambi?
It will not exactly be transferred. It will be given to them for managing.
Okay.
They will manage that refinery. They will run that refinery, basically.
So no incremental capacity would come?
Not no incremental capacity. We have a 200 ton capacity as of now. We would first accredit it or certify it for 200 tons. Once that is done and once we see that gold is selling in the Indian market, and there is no need to import directly from Valkambi, then definitely we will increase the capacity of that in times to come. At least not for the next 1 year.
Sir,
spend somewhere around 10,000 to 12,000 per kg. What do you think after certification, or if not you, what's the Indian margin average? Because people are setting up 50 crore, 100 kg per day facilities, and they are earning on an average 10,000 to 12,000 anyway. So with certification there, what's the margin which is likely to be there?
See, currently whatever we refine, we consume it ourselves. So it doesn't really matter as to what the premium what we get in that, because my bars currently what I'm manufacturing, I will not be able to give it to a bank, I will not be able to give it to an exchange. But now with this certification or this partnership coming in, expertise coming in, we will also be able to give it to a bank, we will also be able to give it to an exchange. So that will increase my production. It's not about exactly increasing the margin. There will be a slight increase in margin. My bars and Valkapi bars, there is a slight difference in premium in the market. If I give soup bars what I am doing now, I get say $1 per ounce, whatever. If I give Valkapi bars, I will get $1.50 per ounce. The 50 cents for $1,100. So there is a slight difference.
30 to 40% jump, that's average we can presume.
30 to 40%
to the Indian market.
The premium.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean 30 to 40% jump in profitability.
No, no.
On the premium, 30-40% jump will be there.
Okay. Now coming to the sales side, like we have the Belgium sale, selling at a premium in the silver coins. How does it sell as a premium in a gold bar market?
In a gold bar market, there are certain products of Valkapi, like the combi bars or the auxiliary bars, etc. What they have done, or the coins of Valkapi which have their finishing, etc. When they are sold in the market, they are definitely sold as premium bars.
But can you quantify premium?
The quantify would be that we are looking at, let's say, about $10 an ounce.
Okay.
If you give that combi bar, it will be around $10 to $12 an ounce premium which we charge. So which comes close to around 0.6 or 0.7% of the value of gold.
Okay, that's what you are trying to say when you want to bridge that 0.1 to...
Absolutely. We are trying to say that, and further when we move forward to jewelry and further value-added products, we are looking at, if we supply directly to the retailer, we are looking at that coming up to the final point of 8 to 10% margin. There is, if you buy a 1 gram bar from anywhere in any market, either from a bank or from any other jeweler, on the gold price there will be a premium of at least around 15%.
Okay.
15%, but that is to a retailer.
Retailer, ultimate consumer.
Ultimate consumer.
Now coming to the third question, that what percentage of 9.45 average is to India at present?
At present, we have derived them, because in India they supply directly and indirectly both.
Correct.
They give it to many banks who ultimately bring it to India.
Correct.
Or they supply directly as Valkapi bars to India.
Correct.
I think about 35% of the total production comes into India. As of
now. So, I presume last year it was 800, so maybe 30% of that.
30% of India and 30% of theirs is one and the same.
Correct.
So
250 or 275.
Yeah, around between 250 to 300 tons is coming.
Okay, so that's when you fit in, where your 200 gets accredited, it can surpass and that differential margin can
it can
come.
Surpass, plus in India we will start selling Valkapi bars more aggressively for that.
Yeah.
We have a grip on the market here, so we will be able to sell it more aggressively, and we will be able to replace the other refineries here.
What is the bar market of India in retail?
The bar market as such, everything in gold goes first as bar itself. There is even
direct bar market.
I know that. So when whoever, even if he wants to make jewelry, he has to buy a bar first and then make it into jewelry.
Correct.
But if you look at that investment bar market, which
right.
public or the common man
yeah.
buys on the street the bars, it is estimated around 12 to 14% of the total sales.
About
150 tons is the total. We consumed about 160 tons of gold. We processed 160 tons of gold.
And how much was out of that from the scrap or resale?
Out of that, then our subsidiary does it all together. I think around 30 to 40 tons should be from recycling, etc. About 110 tons we have imported.
Okay, thanks.
Thank
I'll
you.
Come back again.
Yes, sir. Any other questions, please? Not exactly manufacturing jewelry as such, because manufacturing jewelry will not be suitable in a country like Switzerland, because you need a lot of labor input into it, etc. But we are definitely looking at manufacturing. reaction abroad for doing that? Because Indian, we had a major reaction for the current account deficit situation by India 2 years back, when they clamped on the imports of gold in India. So we had a problem at that time. There is only year our sales have dipped, if you see, among the last all the years. So for that, we already have set up a facility in Dubai to mitigate that. So we would be, when something like this happens, that facility is also growing on its own. When something like that happens, we shift our manufacturing there.
And finally, what's the cost of debt that you're taking from debt?
Well, it would be difficult for me to divulge more details, because I have already received some firing from them in the afternoon of talking about Credit Suisse, that we are not supposed to divulge our name, etc. We don't want publicity. But I had told them that when they ask me, I do need to reveal my source of funds. How can I say I don't know? That will not be proper. So maybe we will leave it at that and not get into the interest rate.
Do you expect any central bank of Europe or somebody coming out with big sale of gold?
I don't think in the current situation any central